This is the College of Complexes. And anybody who hasn't paid the $3 tuition, see me. Beyond that, we have Carrie Layden with us, and she is our speaker tonight. Must-have book, Mayor 1%, Rahm Emanuel, and the Rise of Chicago's 99%.
New mayor.
Well, we're hoping for the rise of the 99%. Our speaker.
Thank you for having me here. I talked once when I was at the Lincoln restaurant, and that was a lot of fun. I was sorry to hear that that restaurant closed, but this looks like a great setup, too. So, thanks for having me here.
Better than the Lincoln.
Yes. there's so much that you can say about Rahm Emanuel, Mayor 1%. I guess I'll start talking about where things stand right now at this moment compared to how they were looking 4 years ago at the same time leading up to the 2011 election where he was first elected. So I think one of the really striking differences between now and then is what Rahm's campaign messages are. So if you remember at this time in 2011, it was already looking pretty clear that he was going to win. It had started out with this field with, initially maybe 8 or 10 names in the ring, and then people were falling by the wayside, and there were a handful of valid candidates by this time, but, it looked pretty clear that Rahm was going to win, and there was also that feeling that even then, a lot of people, regardless of their politics, didn't feel very excited about him, or, already felt kind of skeptical of him, but felt there was this inevitability that he would end up becoming mayor. And I'll talk more about how that compares to kind of the way I see the public mood right now. So his message then was a lot about making the hard choices, about belt tightening, about getting Chicago's budget crisis under control, about the longer school day, language that was not very veiled at all about taking on unions and reining in, the bloated public sector, and it was pretty obvious what he had in mind, and even during the campaign, some of the unions were calling him out on that and realizing that. So, nonetheless, he did get elected pretty easily, avoided a runoff, and then right off the bat in his address when he had just gotten the office, again, it was all about the hard choices, quote-unquote, the belt tightening, the getting the finances under control. And, I think when Rahm was elected the first time, even though, there was, I think, a lot of apathy and skepticism of him even before he won, I think there were also, I talked to a lot of people personally who also had some hope for him and thought, saw him as a good liberal or even a progressive on certain issues and, the guy that gets things done. And I think a lot of people were actually hopeful of him doing some good things as mayor. So he takes office in May of 2011 and right off the bat really picked fights with unions and, did a lot of that belt tightening and slashing he talked about right away with services and with public workforces. The fight with the teachers union started even before he took office, but he started moving immediately to implement that longer school day and just skirting the contract that the teachers union had and his appointed school board. I know you mentioned the push for an elected school board. His appointed school board went ahead and froze the raises that the teachers had in their contract. So that was, that was shaping up as a battle pretty early on. So the thing that, I think a lot of people didn't know about Rahm or just didn't realize or didn't give enough credence during the 2011 campaign was really what his political character is. And, people that did kind of study, you don't even need to really study it, but take note of his record in Washington and his past, you could see that he really was the epitome of a new Democrat, a neoliberal centrist Democrat. He was one of the key members of the DLC, the whole idea of bringing the Democratic Party to have more of a focus on the private sector and the supposed, you know, kind of trickle-down effect as opposed to a really, really healthy social safety net. So that stuff was actually, and that's part of what I catalog in the book. There was plenty to show that that's the kind of political animal he was, even before he was elected. But I think people didn't fully realize that and also didn't realize how important that would be when he became mayor. You know, things that he did in the White House, he took a lot of credit for passing NAFTA when he was in the Clinton White House. Something like that is very similar in political philosophy to what he's done as mayor of Chicago, but you know, it doesn't immediately translate. So I mean, probably a lot of people here were thinking and talking about those issues, but you know, the general voter public in Chicago probably didn't see that as a problem. So he takes office, you know, immediately starts dismantling a lot of social services and cutting public jobs, and I think, is that okay? And then also realizing actually fairly quickly that he couldn't have quite as much of a steamroller approach as he had wanted. He ended up making up with some of the unions that he alienated right off the bat and, you know, cutting some deals, but not with the teachers union. It was all out war with the teachers union. And then, I mean, we can go back and talk more about, you know, so much has happened in these past 4 years, we can go back and talk more about it, but I'll try to move forward for now to my original opening point, which is how that message he had during the first campaign compares to his message now. And, you know, now you see he's not talking about belt tightening, he's not talking about hard choices. It's all about trying to repair the damage that he's done to his public image. It's all about what he's done for the people, you know, what he's supposedly done for the South and West Sides, and, you know, for the 99% who he knows very well are pretty pretty disenchanted with him right now, to say the least. People probably saw the first TV ad that he put out there was taking credit for closing the coal plants, and that was a pretty direct, you know, everyone knows his main challenger now is Chuy Garcia from Little Village, with roots in Little Village in Pilsen, and then also Bob Fioretti. So this ad taking credit for closing the coal plants, which were, they're closed now, the buildings still stand in the Pilsen and Little Village neighborhoods, you know, is a very direct, transparent way to try to say he did this great thing for low-income immigrant families in Little Village, and also to directly try to talk to the strong base for Chuy Garcia. And the coal plants, that's, you know, far from the truth. He came in at the last minute when there'd been a strong movement. I think people here were probably involved with it, a movement for more than a decade to close or clean up these coal plants. And the supposed deal that Rahm actually cut to close them, they ended up closing even earlier than the deal mandated. They were bound to close for financial reasons anyway, mostly because of fracking and cheap natural gas competing with them and making them not economical. And the deal that he actually cut in a way made things worse, because part of that deal involved the dropping of lawsuits against other coal plants run by that same company, Midwest Generation. So this, you know, really pretty phony accomplishment that he stole credit for and, you know, actually played a negative role in, is what he chose to make his first ad that was supposed to appeal to the, you know, part of the 99% that he so much alienated. And then other ads talking about the kindergarten, and the billboard on the Stevenson Expressway with him, and the plugging his support from the pipe union trades, which is one. I mean, you know, we are doing this big overhaul of the sewer and water system, so his administration has created a bunch of union jobs in that respect. So that was a, you know, sort of an easy card he could play to try to win back some of the union support. And then just, you know, just in the past couple days, making this vague promise for reparations for the victims of John Burge's torture. And this is pretty convenient. You know, the election's only, what, 5 weeks away. So he can say that, and there's no way there's going to be concrete action before the election. So, you know, he previously issued an apology to John Burge victims, and now he's kind of offering money, but not making any concrete promises, and, you know, probably running the clock out. That's something I think he's done a lot in general and really not been called on enough. he mentioned in the when all the kids were coming from Central America, he made this announcement about being a welcoming city and building some sort of refuge for kids coming from Central America. And you know, the flow of kids I think has slowed, but I've never read about any concrete action on that front. You know, I think there's a lot of these kind of empty promises that sound appealing to immigrants and to even progressive or liberal people. And those have accelerated during the campaign. You know, there's a ribbon cutting at a park, it seems like, every day. Going back, you know, the minimum wage, passing the $13 minimum wage, which is not near what the actual workers' rights groups had pushed for, the $15, and the $13 doesn't take effect until 2019. But, you know, on the national landscape, the increased minimum wage is something you can point to as doing something for working people. He supported the passage of the SRO, the ordinance to protect some affordable SRO housing last fall. So this kind of drumbeat of things that are pretty obviously calculated to bolster his image leading up to the election, and again, really different message from the one that he had 4 years ago. So the question is it going to work, and what's going to happen on February 24th, and I'd love to hear people's thoughts on that. Personally, well, you know, for one thing, just in terms of the kind of drama, if Chuy Garcia were to somehow win, I think this would be a Hollywood movie in the making, because the whole, you know, the growing, brewing discontent of people and the show of solidarity for unions and for the whole concept of workers' rights during the teacher strike. You know, there's been this building momentum happening at the same time as the Occupy movement and this growing class consciousness in Chicago, and then that leads up to Karen Lewis. You know, it appeared Karen Lewis being in the race with Rahm and actually polling ahead of Rahm during the summer or early fall. So, you know, that looked like it was going to be an epic showdown over really two totally separate political worldviews, opposing political views. And then, of course, Karen, you know, total shock to everyone, having to withdraw for health reasons, and then Chuy Garcia, who, you know, he says hadn't even considered running until that happened, jumping in the race with Karen's support, and, you know, then with the teachers' union support, and with a lot of labor support, and with a deep base in labor and progressive and immigrants' rights circles, and history with Harold Washington. So, and then, you know, Bob Fioretti has been making some good points all along, or for a while at least, in city council, been one of the only people to speak out against Rahm. So, you know, if there were to be a runoff, and then if one of the opponents, it would be more likely Chuy Garcia, were to actually win, it would be a kind of story that Bill de Blasio was in New York, or maybe even more dramatic in some ways. And I know a lot of people have gotten, you know, were getting really excited about Karen and then have gotten really excited about Chuy as well. We'll see what happens when the election comes around. It does look like from the poll numbers and just from what you hear on the streets that people are already assuming that Rahm's going to be reelected. And, you know, of course, you always mention the money. He spent a lot of it now, but his total war chest, I think, was $11.2 million. And Chuy had something like, I think, 900,000 or so, and Fioretti maybe 400,000, something like that, before, you know, not counting what they've spent. So obviously everyone else is way outmatched in dollars, and, you know, Rahm could probably bring in pretty much unlimited amounts of additional money as the election gets closer if he feels that he needs it. I personally, you know, really wish I understood better how that money can be leveraged when, I know how it can be leveraged, but, you know, it is curious that someone who has been so unpopular and has alienated so many people from all different sectors can still just apparently win an election with money. You know, it's not a matter of advertising. I'm sure his ads help, but, you know, most people hopefully do know who he is and have an opinion about him already that, you know, hopefully a few ads wouldn't change. And then obviously there's the whole issue of getting the vote out on election day. So I think it is, you know, it is a pretty telling moment in Chicago's history, or, you know, about the whole nature of, you know, how people in Chicago, how people feel empowered or not to determine their leadership and, you know, their voice that they have in the city of Chicago. I'm jumping around a little bit from what I was planning to talk about, but I guess I'll just jump ahead. I want to come back to a few things, but I'll just jump ahead to what happens if, well, no, a few more things that I think are worth mentioning on the just sort of image front and, you know, what Rahm means for Chicago. People probably saw the Chicagoland series that aired, I guess it was almost a year ago now. Yeah?
Would you slow down?
Oh, sure.
Distinctly?
Okay.
Older crowd.
Okay, I'll do that. Yeah, okay, I'll talk a little slower.
You put five sentences and you ordinarily would go in one sentence.
Okay. I think I probably do that in my writing too. I've had editors tell me that, so. So let me think. One thing that's worth talking a little bit more about is Rahm's relationship with the African American community, which I know isn't a monolithic community, but that was, you know, throughout Chicago's history, has been a really important part of the city and been a third of the population, and, you know, obviously amazing civil rights legacy here and really important African American leaders. And one thing that Mayor Daley, I mean, one difference when people are asked about the differences between Mayor Daley and Rahm Emanuel, one thing that people always point out is Daley really, whether you liked him or not, he really knew how to work the communities, and he had his proxies in different neighborhoods and different communities and different constituencies, and he had strong relationships with different African-American ministers and community leaders, and, you know, and same for other different immigrant communities. And Mayor Daley ended up being kind of a leader for gay rights in some ways. So, you know, he really, people will say that Mayor Daley, whether you liked him or not, was a neighborhood guy and knew the neighborhoods of Chicago and would be out there walking the streets. And even someone, I forget who it was, a reporter I know, said he had been with Mayor Daley visiting the families of some murder victims, and that they felt that Daley really, you know, hurt for those families and really cared. So I'm not saying this to begin a whole you know, praise session for Mayor Daley, but I think all along people could tell that, you know, even during his candidacy, there was this idea the first time around, this idea that Rahm Emanuel wasn't a real Chicagoan, and people have always felt that, and I think it's become only stronger over time, and especially pronounced on the South and West Side, largely Black neighborhoods, where he's cut thousands of city jobs, and a disproportionate number of those jobs have been Black workers. The teachers union, led by an African American woman, a large, high proportion of the union members are African American women. And this is the union that Rahm Emanuel not only picked a fight with, you know, mayors are supposed to fight with unions over the contract, but picked a fight over their whole existence and their whole value as human beings and as workers, almost calling them greedy and selfish and blaming them for hurting the kids in these neighborhoods, which obviously there's so many other reasons that test scores are low in some of these neighborhoods and that families are suffering. Starting, you know, probably about a year and a half ago, I think Rahm Emanuel started to make some really concerted efforts to win back African American voters, you know, voters. He did things like naming, you know, this kind of backfired, naming the street for Bishop Frazier, which turned out was something that people didn't actually want. Getting the Whole Foods in Englewood, probably a good thing, but, you know, seems like sort of a token gesture. Making the apology for John Birch. A lot of things that were, to me, seemed like sort of easy things to do that were meant to bolster his image and, you know, at the same time continuing to cut services, close schools, close the almost 50 schools in majority Black neighborhoods, things that were actually really hurting people and that no little you know, largely token gestures could actually even come close to ameliorating. So that's, you know, that's one thing where it will be really interesting in the election too. Now there's really there's a few African American candidates, but you know, no one who's really looking strong in polls. Obviously, with Karen Lewis in the race, it would have been a whole different story. Chuy Garcia does have actually a long history working with civil rights movements and with Mayor Hal Washington, and you know, specifically in his past, having a really strong base with Black voters. So you know, I'm curious how that ends up playing out in the election, and if he's able to remind people of that, or to, you know, kind of recreate that feeling after having some time as Cook County Commissioner and posts where, you know, he's not necessarily been as visible to your average person. So I think if Rahm does win on February 24th or in the runoff in April, then it will be really interesting to see what actually happens and how he behaves from there on out, because he definitely has realized as mayor that it's not going to be as easy as he thought it would to just waltz in and do what he wanted with the city and privatize all the things he wanted to privatize and slash all the things he wanted to slash. The thing I forgot to even mention so far was closing the mental health clinics, that the 6 of the city's 12 mental health clinics were closed in 2012, and that's continued to be a huge issue, really a big campaign issue. It's been one of the main issues that Bob Fioretti keeps talking about. So that's just one example. He thought that would be the stroke of a pen. I'm sure he thought that he could do that and never give it a second thought. And that's continued to plague him for more than 3 years. He's definitely learned he has to change what he would like to do a little bit, and to at least make more of a show of taking input. And I wouldn't even call it community participation, is far from that, but at least to be a little bit less autocratic. We have seen that. Once he's reelected, will that continue, or will he feel that now, after winning, even when his popularity was so low, he has just a total mandate to do whatever he wants, especially if you think he, you know, may not want a third term. It's probably highly likely that he wants to just finish what he started in Chicago and move on to something else. So if that's how he's thinking, then there's even less motivation for him to care at all about what anyone thinks of what he does. I think one good example on this front is the whole situation with the Obama Library. Even at a moment when Rahm is trying hard to make it look like he's doing things for regular people and specifically for the South Side and for African Americans, even at this moment, he's determined to push through this Obama Library with the University of Chicago proposal, and which has become really, or has been all along, really controversial and opposed by a lot of people in those neighborhoods. It was for a few reasons, one being that some people thought it should be in Pullman, or where Obama had actually, closer to where Obama had done his community organizing, or in other locations other than Hyde Park. And now there's the situation where if it is to be in Hyde Park for the University of Chicago, they'll need to take public parkland in parks that are really Jackson or Washington parks that are really beloved by people. And people also see it as furthering the ongoing expansion and land grab and gentrification that the University of Chicago is causing in the surrounding neighborhoods. So Rahm is determined to push that library through and to take the parkland if it needs to be taken in order to get the library there. So I think that's telling of, you know, even when he is trying to mollify these communities, when it comes down to the larger national stage and his political legacy, he'll really do anything. You know, getting the library in Chicago, that's one of the things that will be a notch on his belt when everything else, when the mental health clinics are long forgotten by at least by his friends in high places. So I think that's what we'll see more of if he's reelected, is just his way at all costs. And then there's the other, just one last angle I want to explore before we talk and have questions and rebuttals, is the movement for a more independent city council. A few groups that people probably know, Take Back Chicago and the Reclaim Chicago movement, and a lot of activists and groups have sort of, I don't mean this to be disparaging, but have kind of just given up or, set aside the mayor's race and focused on city council races and the whole goal of getting more independent aldermen in city council, more progressive aldermen specifically. So I think that's a really interesting movement and a really interesting strategy. And there's a handful of wards that are really interesting races where some candidates who I think are exciting and are genuine grassroots leaders, including a couple teachers union members, actually have a chance of winning. So that's a big deal in Chicago. But the dark or the flip side of that is, even if you have a better city council, a more independent city council, cynically, how much of a difference is that going to make? Because we have a lot of, I hope so, ordinances that have majority support, that have 26 to 35 out of 50 aldermen supporting them, but they still don't pass because they get buried in the rules committee or in some other committee where Rahm's allies won't call them for a vote, so they can't move to the full city council. And then, of course, the mayor can still veto an ordinance if he wants to. And then Rahm, even when you do get more progressive people in city council who are trying to do the right thing, the mayor just has a lot of power. And he has, right now, he has this PAC that has $3 million or more that can be used to try to unseat any aldermen who haven't towed the line. I think those movements to get more independent aldermen are really exciting, but I think they're also an uphill battle. And, that's where I guess in Rahm's second term, if he does have one, a lot of it will come down really to people just fighting for their rights on individual issues, things like the teachers going on strike when Rahm had actually helped work to pass a law that everyone thought would make it impossible for them to strike, and they did, and they basically won the strike, something like that. Things like the mental health movement, they haven't gotten the clinics reopened, and they probably won't, but they've made really great strides in probably protecting the clinics that remain and keeping it an issue on the front burner. The Fight for 15 campaign is what got the $13 minimum wage, wouldn't have happened without that. So things like that. I think everyone who's opposing Rahm and who's working on these aldermanic races also sees their efforts as part of a larger movement that will extend beyond this election and will hopefully bear fruit in other ways down the line. And so, that's, if you want to talk about the rise of the 99%, you could argue how much the 99% has actually risen, how much they will continue to rise, but I think that's the, that's the thing to, I guess, to look out for. So, I'll leave it at that, but do questions or?
All right. Okay, your first question. I'm from McHenry County. The government just runs. It's controlled by Republicans. They build their roads, they get their tax revenue, and yet they have a positive income balance on most of their functions. The county's growing, it's got jobs, and it's under Republican control. Can't maybe Rahm Emanuel learn something from the Democrats in the city of Chicago?
Learn something from McHenry?
From the McHenry County.
I don't know anything about McHenry County, but I imagine it's easier to run than Chicago and you know, the pensions are such a big issue here, which aren't directly Rahm's fault. So I don't know, maybe he can learn from them, but I think there's a lot of people he could learn from who he's not listening to, so yeah.
Bernie?
Maybe you can explain something which is in the buzz around the 49th Ward. I think you're probably familiar with some of the folks up there. My Alderman Joe Moore is said to have voted about 51% with Richard M. Daley, but close to 100% with Rahm Emanuel. Can you explain why that might be?
And that's a really interesting situation. And I've interviewed Joe a number of times. And, you know, as a journalist, I have always appreciated how accessible he is. So anyway, you know, I mean, I think the sort of obvious, the answer that people could sort of gather is that he sees Rahm, well, on one hand, liberal on social issues that Joe Moore supports, and then as someone who's really powerful, who can help Joe Moore. You know, he was looking at, some time ago, wanting to be head of the Illinois EPA, and, you know, I'm sure a lot of people, even if, I'm not saying anything about Joe here, but in general, a lot of people, even if they dislike Rahm, figure that it's smart to hitch their wagon to him, so I'm sure there's some of that.
Hey, Steve.
You mentioned about there's exciting alderman races to watch and more independents. Can you give us three wards to watch? I would love to watch those three wards. What's the top three wards where independents are coming in and get big duking it out? Can you give us three wards?
Yeah, and other people might want to add to this later, but three that I would say, one I'm personally really interested in is the 10th Ward, which is the southeast side where you have the battle over the pet coke, petroleum coke. Olga Bautista is one of the community activists against the pet coke. She's running, and Sue Garza, and I think it's Rich Martinez, another activist, are running against John Pope, who's one of those entrenched aldermen. In Pilsen, this is skewed by where I live, but in Pilsen, Danny Solis, you know, Rahm's kind of one of his right-hand men, is being challenged by a socialist candidate, Jorge Mujica, and Byron Sigcho, who's backed by the Pilsen Alliance, a good grassroots candidate.
What ward is that?
25th.
So you get the 10th, the 25th, and what else?
Yeah, I'll say also the 12th, which is back of the yards, where Pete DeMay, who's real progressive, is challenging George Cardenas, who's another just kind of long time. And then there's a few, we can talk about others later, there's a few where teachers' union people are running. And
okay, thank you.
Hey.
Hi, Carrie. How are you? Good to see you. You know, I've always wondered, back in 2011, when he got elected, there was a story that he had threatened a state legislator with having his home burned down because he wasn't willing to vote the way Rahm wanted on the pension issue, you know, the city pension issue, or the state pension issue. And it was in the news, and nobody denied it. Yet, and you know, you would think that says Rahm's a pretty bad role model for a lot of things. You know, like street games. What kind of role modeling is that? But, you know, it never appeared. You know, it's like it just disappeared. And that would seem like something that would be relevant to a campaign. Do you know anything about that?
You know, I don't remember that. I'm going to go look it up.
Yeah.
I mean, I would guess, you know, without knowing anything about it, that maybe it wasn't taken seriously, because obviously he's famous for his dead fish and, you know, things like that.
Well, again, and that's really bad role modeling when you're the mayor of this city when we have the huge street gang population, which is because there aren't jobs, you know. And so that would be something to look into. And, you know, there's not too many journalists, it seems like, around anymore who are willing to be critical in that way.
I think, you know, just real quick on that, I mean, I agree with all that. And I think there actually has been a, you know, decent amount of good critical journalism in Chicago, but the national journalism has been so pro-Rahm, and I think that's what he cares about more. So there needs to be more in Chicago too, but yeah.
So, Colin?
Yeah, well, you're talking about 1%. We know that the Pritzkers are part of the 1%, and probably the banks and the big industrialists. Could you name specifically who the people are that are 1% in Chicago?
Oh man, I don't know. Off the top, you know, the Reader did, I think it was Mick Dumke and Ben Jarofsky did a great story, and I could get this to anyone who's interested. They actually got Rahm's personal schedule to show who he was meeting with, and it was, you know, and I'm sorry all the names aren't fresh in my mind, but it was all these hedge funds and investment banking people, and also Hollywood, you know, financiers, Hollywood people. So those would be some of the, you know, the type of 1% that are his donors and his circle, basically. And that particular article showed how much time he was meeting with them versus very little time with, you know, community leaders. And, yeah.
All right. Carl?
I know one of the things that Rahm had championed, let's say, was that he was going to have 100 miles of bike lanes in the city, like every year. Do you know, like, how far along is this program? And the other thing was, he said that he wanted to make Chicago the most bike-friendly city in the nation. So where are we at on that standing?
That's a good, and I see your shirt. Yeah, so I think the promise was 100 miles in 4 years and 25 miles a year. And I know he has created a lot of bike lanes. And I'm a huge biker, and that is one thing I appreciate. But I see that as, you know, again, something that's relatively easy to do. And also, this is another, I'm sorry to digress, but I think another important point is he's really made this whole issue of courting the quote-unquote creative class, you know, the hipsters, the graphic designers, the computer programmers, you know, the 1871, the startup entrepreneurs. And he said himself, Rahm has, that things like bike lanes and like these co-working spaces and, you know, urban gardens, which I like all of those things, but he said himself that those are very concerted attempts to attract this creative class to Chicago. And the bike lanes, I think it is pretty clear that they're disproportionately north side also. I'd like to look at that more closely. But yeah, that's a good question.
Dave Zucker?
Yes. You were about to comment earlier on the Chicagoland TV series, and I was wondering if you'd finish your thoughts on that.
Yeah. Yeah, so that was, you know, this 8-part series that it turned out, Rahm claimed at first that he hadn't even watched it, and then the Tribune got emails that showed very extensive communications between the producers and Rahm. I think that actually is pretty normal when you're working with a source, so I don't really condemn the producers of Chicagoland for doing that. But whether he participated in it or not, the image it showed was really an extended campaign commercial and was almost laughable how it showed him being the savior of the South Side and juxtaposing. The series in a way did a good job juxtaposing the two Chicagos, the glitzy, you know, there was one, actually this, I really liked how they did this. They showed this competition between startups where it was all this drama of which startup will win for their, you know, some ad campaign for Diet Coke, juxtaposed with the opening day of Fenger High School and, you know, would there be shootings on the opening day. I think the, as it turned out, the series was very much orchestrated as something to, by Rahm at least, who knows what the producer's original intent was, but it ended up being a great piece of propaganda, but also one that people really saw through. The ratings were low and the reviews were bad, so that's an example of where I think he actually is kind of not as brilliant a strategist and a spin doctor as people think he is.
Can we find the series online?
I think so, at least excerpts, yeah.
From the dump, from who
CNN.
Produced?
It's on CNN's website.
Okay.
Margaret?
What do you think his real, does he have a real goal beyond being mayor for life? If he loses now, how would that affect that if he does have one?
Yeah, I mean, this is only speculation, but he's so ambitious. I'm sure that the highest office possible, whether it's president or, you know, secretary of state or something bigger than mayor, I mean, I'm sure he thinks that. And, you know, if he loses, on one hand, you hear that he doesn't like to lose an argument or anything, so I'm sure he'd be really mad in that sense. But, you know, in the bigger picture, the people that back him, the politicians and the money people that back him, probably won't really care. They'll say, oh, you know, you were too, you know, those, like, chuckling, like those unions got one over on you or something. That's just my image. You know, I think he's the kind of echelons that he's moving in, that he probably could survive a loss as mayor of Chicago. And, yeah, it's just my guess.
Yes. Okay, I haven't investigated this completely or researched it, but a friend of mine sent me something saying that Wilson had backed Rohner in the past, and he could be like a Rahm plant to try to capture the African-American vote and really split the vote, that if he actually got more votes than Fioretti or Chewy, that he could be the contender. Or something, I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, I know people are saying that, and he did back Rohner, but he is a Republican, Willie Wilson. So honestly, I mean, splitting the vote in the primary doesn't matter. It actually is kind of good to have a lot of strong candidates, because as long as Rahm gets less than 50%, he's in the runoff. And I just don't see how Willie Wilson could get more votes than Chewy or Bob Fioretti. So I personally don't think that's the case, but at the same time, you know, you never know. I mean, weird things happen, so I guess you never know.
Doesn't the runoff, though, go to the highest?
Yeah, but...
bitter for against Rahm?
Yeah, so if Willie Wilson got more votes than all the other opponents, he would be in the runoff, but I don't see that happening. I mean, the black population isn't big enough to do that alone, and I wouldn't see Willie Wilson getting many other votes, so I don't think realistically that would happen. You know, but anyway, I could be wrong, and Rahm, and, you know, there's other African-American candidates in there, too, that I'm sure Rahm didn't put any of them. Well, actually, there was speculation that Robert Shaw was put up to it by Rahm. I have no idea if that's true. I think that was just, like, some gossip or whatever. So, who knows?
Okay, we have two Charleses, Charles Paydock and then Charlie Custer.
Yeah, we had a group called Privatization Watch against public-private partnerships, and Emanuel put together this investment trust. Carrie, have you heard anything lately about what they were going to outsource city functions, contracting out? Anything lately about what's going on with that?
Yeah, that's the infrastructure trust. And when that was announced, it made national headlines in Washington Post, everything. It was supposed to be this really groundbreaking, I think it was $700 million project where they would get private investment to make investment in infrastructure like the CTA. The first project was supposed to be overhauling city buildings for energy efficiency, and then you would pay back the investors with the energy savings. And so the infrastructure trust has been a huge failure, like basically nothing has happened. This was really funny, actually. One of the only, even the building thing didn't work out. One of the only projects they've announced is they retrofitted a pool or two. So that was this $700 million thing. So that's a perfect example of even the things that are supposed to be his forte, like he has not succeeded in pulling off in many situations.
All right. Yes, Charles?
Well, we learned in your, before you started the announcements today, you know, that Illinois is number one most bankrupt state in the union, but we actually have more credit than that. Don't we? That Chicago is the number one most bankrupt city that hasn't declared bankruptcy yet. And that was the situation when Rahm came into office, and he came in sort of acting like Walker up in Wisconsin, I'm going to be rough and tough and kill all the unions and balance the budget. So he's not saying anything about balanced budgets now, and I know that we're still hemorrhaging money, but I'm curious whether how you see his attack on the really significant budget difficulty Chicago faces, whether he's made any progress and whether that's an issue where he's vulnerable.
Yeah, I mean, I know he has made progress, and actually it is kind of strange that he's not trumpeting that more. That may be because the progress was tied to all these cuts, so he doesn't want to remind people of the cuts. Because he has, you know, he did get, he has improved the budget situation, and then with the pensions, part of it is out of his control because of the state law. It's not out of his control, but it's complicated by needing to get a state law passed. And I mean, I think personally that his idea of increasing property taxes to cover the pensions is actually a good idea. I mean, there's other ways you can do it too. So anyway, I'm guessing for the election that those issues are both too complicated and also remind people too much of the cuts he's made, that he's just steering clear of them, probably.
Living in a building with seniors, I see a lot of the police, usually with ambulances, and also the fire department. Rahm didn't ever expand the police department, which has been contracting its membership, its constituency. What's happening with that? Is there a possibility that we will see more police and better enabled and so on? My impression is that the present police commissioner is doing fairly well with what he's got. But I don't know what the complaints are. I don't know what the prospects are.
Yeah, so, the police union really hates Rahm. And the big issue with the police has been that instead of hiring extra officers, he's relying on overtime. And, you know, at least critics of that argue that that costs us more in the long run, and it also means more tired officers working. And then he also was kind of playing with the numbers when he said he would put more officers on the street, and then he reassigned people from desk jobs. So anyway, so his opponents have called for hiring more officers, but that's also controversial among progressives, since there are so many problems with the police department. A lot of people don't want more police, so that's kind of a sticky issue.
Accountability questions.
Yeah, right.
Let's see. You've had a question, Tim Boulder.
Okay. This is a little cynical. I can go into McHenry County and buy a pack of cigarettes for about $7.75 a pack. I go into downtown Chicago, they're almost $13 a pack. Now, the thing is, I know I'm being cynical with the cigarette tax, but it seems to me that Rahm does this a lot with user fees and has been driving a lot of people out of the city because of these taxes. Not the big ones, but the little ones that are going up, up, and up.
Yeah, that's definitely true, and he's been transparent about that. It's things that are regressive taxes that hit lower-income people harder. Cable, I think they rolled back the cable fees, but all kinds of fees and fines for all these small infractions. And then, of course, towing and well, parking is a whole other issue with the meters, but that's definitely true. But, you know, he does say that his hands are tied on raising property taxes, so he has to do it with these other small taxes that definitely do hit moderate and low income people harder. So yeah, that's true.
Yes.
So I just wanted to say that on the pensions, there was
a question.
I need to say something about this.
All right. Well,
they've actually passed a law that has reduced the cost of living for the pensions.
Yeah.
So that's separate from the state bill, and that's actually going into effect, but it's being challenged in court. But my question to you was, can you say anything about what happened to the commissioner of the health department? Because I noticed he's no longer the commissioner.
Yeah, I don't know what happened to him. I think I'm forgetting what other job he got. Dan might know.
They say it was a job with a salary of about 700 grand.
Oh.
Something like
that. Yeah. It's a mercy hospital. I went to Mercy Hospital.
Chuck, we have issues with this guy coming and filming here without our knowledge and all that, and without an announcement. So
right.
I don't know why he continues to do the same shit.
Put it away. Put it away.
We have our own filming. We don't need yours. We don't have. We don't need yours. And we announced it before. We object.
I won't film you all your
No. Put away. Come on, let's go on with the program.
That's a good idea.
I think it's a good idea.
Next question.
Next question.
You see, he doesn't even go by the group. The group is telling
you. Question is next.
Okay.
Ecology complexes?
We have a thing if you don't want to.
You let this man from another country make two.
Oh. You're a foreigner, Frank. You don't come.
Green card. Where's the green card, gentlemen? Green card, gentlemen.
Come on.
You're slipping the program.
Can we please get on with this?
Will you put the
Social Security card check? Where is that?
I know.
I'm
talking
about this. Who has the
next? Yes.
Can we please get on with the show?
Who has the next?
That job once a year.
It's just
one call at a time.
I don't think so.
Yeah,
I'm
disrupting
everything.
Hey, are you Ed Sullivan?
Are you Ed Sullivan?
Yeah, I'm the
No, thank God I'm not.
This is our YouTube. I'll ask the question myself.
Are you?
Chewy Garcia or any of the others, other prospective candidates, do they propose an elected board of education?
Yeah. I think that both Chewy and Bob Fioretti back an elected school board. I'm pretty sure that's true. Don't quote me on that, but that has been obviously one of the huge issues for opponents of Rahm. So, yeah, I'll double check.
Yes. Okay. No other questions? Shall we move to our rebuttal period already?
I got it.
Come on. Yes.
So can you talk more about your book? Push your book and why the title 1%? I really didn't hear you mention about that and saying how bad the 1% is. I really want you to talk bad about 1%.
Okay.
it's not obvious.
Yeah, no, that's a good question. So the book is part sort of a biography of Rahm, and then also, it gives his history, some of his things, how he got his political start, how he has been part of the Chicago Democratic machine all along, even though a lot of people don't see him that way, how he's been, how he is, is both part of the 1% and has really throughout his political career worked to further the interests of the 1%. He worked in investment banking for just 2.5 years and made over $18 million in that time. So that shows, and he had no degree in business. That was basically, so that kind of shows, the value of political connections and political power. So my book talks about, I could talk about that longer, but I'll keep it brief, his connection to the 1% and to high finance, and then how his political character in Congress and in the Obama White House and the Clinton White House, and even back with Mayor Daley, has manifested as mayor of Chicago. And then the book goes through, it goes through the teacher strike and his first budget. I forget when it cuts off, but it basically also chronicles, his actions for at least the first 2 years of his term, and then also the movement against him and what that signifies. So, yeah, and you know, this was all happening also at the same time as the Occupy movement and the whole idea of Wall Street versus Main Street. So he really is, he became known as Mayor 1%, like during the teacher's strike, and ever since that's been his nickname, you know, not in a positive way. And you'll see, he's definitely said things about how he represents the 99% or the 100%. That's one of his messages now, so.
Okay.
This is maybe a naive question, but I'm sure everybody here would like to know the answer to this. I don't know if you are at all the right person to ask it of. You used 1% in the title of your book.
Uh-huh.
What is the income level of the 1%?
There you
I heard
go.
Something
yeah.
on the radio the other day that said that in the United States, it's assets above $700,000. I don't know if that's right or not.
No, I don't know.
High.
It sounds like it would be higher than that. I'm going to look it up. I don't know.
The people you referred to earlier are the...
Like point
over. Right.
Right, right.
But
yeah.
What's the 1%? Is it, you know, some...
I don't know. I know it depends where you live.
You're not one of them.
I looked it up. I looked it up. It's something like $350,000, $400,000.
In that range. It's not
that's
actually lower than I
would have
thought.
That's
really interesting.
No, assets. Assets.
Yearly income around $400,000.
Well, then they got a lot more assets. Yeah.
Yearly income is one thing and assets are another. But, okay, Margaret.
I have heard that when he made that $18 million, that his mentor during that time was Bruce Rauner. Is that true?
Yeah, that is. He helped him get his start in investment banking. And there was another Bruce, I'm blanking on his last name, but another Bruce who helped make the connection too. So yeah.
So is that why he didn't really come out for Quinn?
Well, him and Bruce Rauner are like best friends. Like they vacation together in Montana. So it goes, yeah, they're really close, both in their political, or at least their financial philosophy, and just as personal friends.
But he doesn't have 9 houses.
Rahm? Not that, no, I don't think so.
Dan Bader.
Yeah, a couple of questions. One is, you know, in Forbes magazine, they put out this list of the 15 wealthiest people, or some number. You know, if you total it up, it comes out to about $40 billion. The pension shortfall for the city of Chicago is usually cited as around $20 billion. So, you know, common sense says, you know, all they'd have to do is chip in half of their billions, and they'd still be billionaires.
Yes!
That would save the city. Now, they don't have any intention, of course, of going there. I mean, that's something Rahm never is going to say. You know? He's never going there. But, you combine...
maybe there's good reasons not to push for the financial transactions tax. And just on that point with how much these wealthy people could pay, I mean, companies like, not just individuals, but companies like, you know, with the stuff with the tips, not only are they not paying more to help Chicago, but they're actually getting all these breaks and subsidies beyond what a mom and pop store would get. So, yeah, it's so crazy.
Mary Bennett.
Yes, I was informed that the financial elites got together and introduced a bill in Springfield prohibiting the city of Chicago from even considering such a, you know, tax.
I'm not so, sure. That sounds vaguely. Yeah, that could be. I'm not sure. I wouldn't doubt it.
All right, Steve.
Here's the question up front is, are we that naive, or were we that naive when Rahm came to town? Everyone in this room and city, I think it was 70% of us, said, that's the man. And now I hear nothing but vilification at this point.
Yeah. Yeah.
Where, are we that naive? Are we that dumb?
Well, it's 70% of who voted, which, you know, is actually a pretty relatively small number, so...
Well, that's not right. That's the voters, yeah. The voters.
Yeah, but I mean, of the people who actually went to the polls and voted,
that's
so...
That's not right.
Yeah, right,
the
right.
ones that didn't vote, the hell with you. The hell with you. Yeah.
Yeah, so I don't know. I mean, if that's this sense of apathy or resignation or...
Are we that dumb? We're that dumb, huh?
Yes, we are that dumb when we don't go to the polls.
Yeah.
We're dumb. We're dumb.
Okay.
Another point of view is Chicago used to be a big candy maker.
Right.
It is now. Is that because of the price of sugar? And does that have something to do with the recognition of Cuba?
Texas.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think that relates to Rahm at all, but I did do a story about that when I worked at the Washington Post, and if I'm remembering right, it was because of the Cuban, the FanJul brothers, who are Cubans in Florida, who, you know, and other powerful U.S. sugar interests who enforce, you know, protections for U.S. sugar so that we can't import cheap sugar easily. So I think that's why. Yeah, or either way, it's like U.S. sugar versus foreign cheaper sugar with cheaper labor. So that's a whole other issue. But okay. I don't think Rahm's involved with that. Or maybe.
Well, I mean, we had a couple of governors who went to Cuba on trying to ease the relationships, embargo.
It's not an issue.
All right. Yeah. Okay. Yes. Mike Lee.
Make it look.
You know, do you remember who the candidates were? By the way, top 1% are 14 million in net assets.
Oh, that sounds better.
Or 500,000 in income.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
Who are the candidates? Let me see how my buyer's remorse is.
For last
round.
The first time around? Or you mean now or in 2011?
Yeah, that was the first time, right?
2011 was the first time. Yeah. So the major candidates were Carol Mosley Braun, who was the Black consensus candidate, and she had a disastrous campaign, and Gary Chico, who was, you know, the sort of machine guy, and Miguel Del Valle, who was the progressive favorite, and Patricia Van Pelt Watkins was a community leader. And Doc Walls was in there, so that was the...
Was there a Republican?
I don't remember. I'm not sure. I think there was. I'm not sure, though.
We had him there at the college.
Mm-hmm. Republican.
Oh, you did?
Yes.
That was our guy.
All right. Cubs or Sox fan?
Oh.
Well, I live in Boston, so I guess I'd say Sox.
Oh.
Go back to your country.
Yes.
I wanted to say, I just finished the book this morning, actually. I enjoyed it. And I wanted to say, I like that you did point out, like, when he was in the private sector. I think you said he worked for Goldman Sachs. Is that right?
I think it was for GCTR, Browner's company, actually, I think. He didn't actually work for Goldman Sachs.
I know. I thought you were talking about, like, because I'm just trying to keep it all straight. Like, I know when Obama came in and he was Obama's chief of staff and he helped orchestrate the bailout, correct?
Well, that's complicated. You know, I think in that realm, he actually, in some ways, seemed to be doing good things. This book, Confidence Men by Ron Suskind, is a really detailed behind the scenes account of the Obama White House, and I didn't totally know what to make of Rahm's role, and it's not fresh in my mind, but I mean, he was part of it, but I don't think he was necessarily the worst voice. He might have actually been on the one of the better voices in some ways on that, so that was a complicated situation, I think.
Right.
Yeah.
But you were also pointing out, if I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, that he was kind of covering his own butt, too, because he was involved in some, like, questionable deal.
Oh, I think that's a separate, when he was on the board of Freddie Mac, that's a separate thing, but he did sell profit from his time at Freddie Mac in a way that later became illegal. It wasn't illegal at the time he did it, but it was like insider trading, kind of.
I thought it was great the way you pointed out those, you know, those details that I just didn't really know about before.
Thank you.
Okay. All right.
Let's go to rebuttals.
I'm afraid that you're going to have to sit down and listen to the rest of us. But we do get the final word. David?
All right.
How much time for rebuttals, Prom?
How many? Have words for the rest of us. One, two, three, four, five, six. Oh, come on.
We'll go 5 minutes, Prom. We'll go 5 minutes, Prom.
All right.
No, we'll go five. There'll be more coming.
Well, all right. What five? 5 minutes, and we'll see how it works out. Beyond the... When it comes to about 4 minutes, Jim will give you a signal. And try to wind up. And after 5 minutes, the hook comes out. Okay, and we shuffle you off.
All right.
David?
Rahm Emanuel had changed his address to Washington, D.C., and never really had a right to run for office of mayor.
No.
But apparently, Mr. Obama pulled some strings, and he was allowed to run, and then, of course, he got elected. Since then, he has put in these speed cameras and cleaned up somewhere in the neighborhood of $500 million for the city that he's taken out of the pockets of us common people. And then he has greatly increased the number of photo enforcement cameras.
Good.
And if this man is elected again, I can't see him being elected, and if he is elected, I, in my opinion, either the people of Chicago are nuts or else the election is fixed. I also want to say that if a Obama library is built in the area where they want to build it, in my opinion, this is the worst neighborhood in the entire city of Chicago. And if the Obama Library is built there will be shootings in there, there will be rapes,
Oh, yeah.
There will be great defacement done to the library. The people in that neighborhood are mostly illiterate, and they not only can't read, they don't read. And so there's no reason for a library to be in that neighborhood. And so I give you my particular prediction that within five... Hello! I give you my particular prediction that within 5 to 10 years of it having been built, that it will be shut down.
Nice.
All right. I hope we're going to get better than that.
We just heard a lot of bigotry. A lot of racism and a lot of stereotypes that you get every day in the news. And that's where he gets it from. As far as Rahm Emanuel is concerned, I think of him as more or less a one percenter, and he's attached to the corporate world, he's attached to the banking world. He's not really interested in the average person, but he's a professional politician, which means that he's a professional liar. Most professional politicians are professional liars.
Amen.
The only good mayor we ever had in Chicago was in 1980, Harold Washington. He stood in front of the immigration services and wouldn't allow them to take these people that were here so-called illegally and send them back to wherever they came from. He helped to try to build up the neighborhoods in every part of the city, and he was the only decent mayor we ever had. And as far as Obama is concerned, Obama has interests in these tests that go on in the schools. He's got a lot of investment in it, and he's become a millionaire as a consequence of that. And he's just an opportunist. But the trouble is, in the United States, we go by identity politics as far as nationality is concerned, which is ridiculous. It's the person's program, not his nationality, and not as the ethnic group that counts. And people thought, just because he's black, that he's going to be progressive, which is ridiculous. If you go to Africa, Idi Amin and a lot of dictators come out of there, if they're black or not, if they have money and they have power, that's all they're interested in. And the same thing with Rahm Emanuel. It's all you're interested in is getting ahead. And the only way any of these politicians actually do anything, if people put fire under their ass to make a move, that's the only way they do anything. And that's the only reason that he came out with $13 an hour wage. But that's in about 4 years from now. And by that time, the inflation rate will be up to the sky, and it'll be worth $10 an hour. So it's all ridiculous.
You non-racist?
Al Boyce, Sid.
I agree with a lot of what you said. Yes. Carrie, I'd like to thank you for your presentation and your book. I read it a while ago and I thought it was fascinating. I want to make one comment about this man over here. We don't need any bigotry. You're comment about foreigners in this place, I don't think. Okay. But as for the subject matter, I think that we should ask ourselves one question. Do we, the people, the Chicagoans, the people of the city, decide on the issues of the day? Here's this Lucas Library that they want to plunk down on the lakeside, lakeshore. Then you have Obama, the Obama Library that they want to put in our parkland, okay, which is objectionable. Not because it's in a quote unquote bad neighborhood, but because it's in parks, as far as I'm concerned. There are all kinds of things, red light cameras that one of the speakers mentioned. The administration is raking in millions, hundreds of millions of dollars on our backs. Do we really want these lights? Did anybody see the Tribune series on the red light cameras?
No.
How they're practically stealing our money with these cameras. So to me, the question is, do we have anything to say about these things? And the answer is no. It doesn't matter who we vote for. It doesn't matter if we vote for Rahm Emanuel or whoever, or Chuy Garcia, whoever runs against him. These politicians, as the last speaker said, are basically liars. They're basically plutocrats. They're basically one percenters, or the servants of one percenters. So we don't have a democracy, as I've said many times here before, and that's the big picture that we have to look at. Are we naive? One gentleman's asked. Are we dumb? You mean to tell me that Chicagoans have all been dumb for decade after decade after decade, through the first daily, through the second daily, administration after administration? No, I disagree, respectfully. We aren't dumb. We have no say. It's the system. It's the political system. Voting in one jackass, if I may say, for another, or another. You know, it really doesn't matter, essentially. I'm doing a study right now on the Chicago and the New York City machine, Tammany Hall. Those machines were in place for decades in our country, in two of the biggest cities in our country. And they ran everything. It was like total corruption, or largely corruption. These machines that's what our system is about. It's these mechanisms of control, and they control us one way or another, no matter what we do. So we really have to simply change the entire political system, as I've said many times before. Thanks.
I was very interested in what you had to say about Rahm Emanuel. I thank you for coming out. I do take issue with some of the comments that were made about where they want to put the presidential library. In Jackson Park, which is one of the places they wanted to put, that's in Hyde Park. That's number one. And number two, some of the places that were complained about, some of the people in that neighborhood, so on, they're the ones who need a library the most. And I think it's kind of unfair to make remarks of that sort. Second, I'm in favor of putting the presidential library in Jackson Park or whatever. I'm not happier about losing parkland than anyone else. I think what we gain from having a presidential library makes it worthwhile. The Lucas Library is another question. I don't know whether the city needs that, and even if it does, that it does not need on public land, period. They want to find a place to put it, fine. They can put it in the South Loop or somewhere like that. They don't need to put it anywhere in Burnham Park, period, end of story. As to the comments that were made about political connections making people wealthy, I'm old enough to remember when Richard J. Daley was this city's mayor, the elder Mayor Daley. That kind of stuff went on all the time when he was mayor. And if you didn't make any money when he was mayor, you were simply not that well connected, period, again, period, end of story. Finally, to say that all presidents are one percenters, or they're all liars, We once had a very great president in this country, just before I was born, who was one of the most honest presidents we ever had, and his name was Harry Truman.
Oh! 45-53.
You pardon?
45-53.
Yes.
He dropped the egg bomb, by the way, just so you know.
Yes, I'm well aware of that. I've been aware of that for a long time. And President Truman used to have a saying, no matter what you do in this world, there's always some dumb son of a bitch who won't like it.
Charlie, get up there.
I got a little bit earlier than that. Don't listen to these guys. All right, let's thank our speaker again. I probably got a little bit earlier than usual today. I forgot to make an announcement. I guess a lot of you are not 1%ers, but if you're 99%er, there'll be a meeting here tomorrow, right here at 2 o'clock, the Socialist Party of Chicago. So a little bit different political persuasion.
I'll be eclectic as usual. I don't really follow too much city politics. I'm basically more at the federal level. I will give a little anecdote. Many years ago, I contacted members of Congress regarding a legislative issue affecting the federal employees, and I sat back down, and then I got a call from Rahm Emanuel's office inquiring what the issue was, and they said, if you could just give us some issue, is this an organized labor unit? And I said, yes. They said, we're fully in support of it. So I can't say anything bad in that regard. Regarding speed cameras, I announced earlier that I'm with the public transit group. Speed cameras are very important to those of us who don't drive gas-guzzling SUVs, use public transportation. I've done a lot of research on this topic. You are not likely to survive an altercation with an automobile that exceeds 5 miles per hour. You are likely to not survive. Speed cameras are very important. If you're speeding and you go through red lights, you are endangering my life. And I think not only should you be fined, you should be put in jail for that. Now, regarding these bicycles, I fully cannot comprehend why we need even 1 mile of bike paths. They are bicycles. I mean, come on, we need public transit. I'm not going to use a bicycle on a day like today. I'm not going to ride a bike. I had a bike. One of the tenants gave me a bike. I don't know what this for. Seriously, on one issue, and I have looked at it, I represent at least people on public transit issues looking over the record of Rahm Emanuel. Actually, if you go to our website, you will find some information about that. We have some remarks in which he increased the transit fare, and he said if we didn't like it, he said let them drive. Yeah. on the whole, I've wrestled with this issue. Honestly, I've tried to be objective on it. I've read some of the things put out by the Tribune reporter and things like this. What was the record exactly regarding public transit under this current mayor? We had the Ventura issue, which obviously was an abject failure and criminal activity. There were fare increases. There have been cuts in service. I'm still debating on the issue. It's not all negative. It's not all positive. That's why we really haven't really drawn or made the issue here. We were experiencing an enormous number of doomsday scenarios, and some of the things, the changes made in public transit were at the expense of the operating personnel. I objected to that and have over the years that he was coming down on the operating personnel, and I specified on many occasions when I get on a bus or a train, I don't expect the driver to pay my fare out of his wages and benefits. Well, we should pay that ourselves. But anyhow, thank you very much. It was very informative. All right, come again. And you got another one in there. All right, now you guys behave yourself. Kick your ass out of here.
Freeze you. I'll throw your ass.
All right, thank you for the great presentation with the book called Mayor 1%. Very good. And today, on that note, I want to share that we got an email from Charlie advising us of an initiative that's going to be on the ballot on February 24th. Hopefully everybody marks your calendar on February 24th to come out and vote. The initiative says this: should the city of Chicago or the state of Illinois empower voters and reduce the influence of big special interest money in our elections by financing campaigns using small contributions from voters and a limited amount of public funds? Did everybody understand that? I mean, it's a run-on. And what it's really saying is, do you, we the people, want to finance the politicians?
pocketbooks. Do we want to do that? Does anybody here want to do that?
Yes.
Okay. And the reason that this initiative is on the ballot is because the thinking is, because we don't want a billionaire to give $1 billion to this candidate, and this other candidate get only $500 million to give those spewing hate ads that are worthless anyway. So what they're trying to say with this initiative is, let's be fair. Let's give this politician $10,000, and let's give this politician $10,000, and that's all they get, and they go at it. But that's our $10,000. That's my $10,000. That's your $10,000. So how is that fair? I want the wealthy people to waste their money on your campaign. I want the wealthy to waste their money on your campaign. I don't want to be a part of it. I'm going to take you real quickly through this scenario, what's going to happen. Just think about this before you say yes or no to the initiative on February 24th. In year one, you get $10,000 for your campaign of public financing. You get $10,000. In year number two, guess what? They're going to complain to everybody that $10,000 is not enough for all that hate literature and hate campaigns. They're going to want $15,000 in year two. $15,000. Year three, they're going to want some outrageous amount, and we're going to give in somehow, some way. And guess what? Year four, the politicians will craftily ask us on another initiative, we don't want to waste your good people's time. Why don't you just give us the power to raise or lower that limit as we see fit? So what does that mean? We went from no taxpayer money financing your campaigns to $10,000 in year one to unlimited taxpayer money in year four. Think about it, folks. Think about it before you say yes to this campaign initiative. Please. I'm not telling you whether to vote yes or no. Think about it, how things happen. Toll roads are temporary, weren't they? They became permanent. Just think about these things that happen in the public eye, in our wonderful, trusted government. Say no. I'm asking you to say no. But if you want to say yes, just get ready to pay more taxes. It's not the way it's supposed to work. Thank you, Charlie, for the initiative.
Thank you, Kelly. I really enjoyed your talk, and I'm reading in process of reading your book. It's been sitting on the shelf for a while. I would just like to straighten out some people about what a presidential library is. It is not a neighborhood local library. It is where the president puts his papers and all his stuff, and people who are doing work on his stuff come there to do research on it. So, this sort of massive ignorance and stupidity that was evinced up here is really amazing. And so, that's about all. I guess I would say a lot of other things, but I'm not very well organized tonight. Thank you.
All right.
Margaret may be not well organized, but she certainly makes the point as succinctly.
All right. Okay. My turn.
The one thing that always amazes me about every tax-paying citizen is how inefficient they think government is. About how government doesn't work. And about how government has to cut spending. But at the same time, they'll be the first to get really mad when the roads aren't fixed, when the lights don't work, when there's crime. So my question to a lot of you guys is this. You know, Rahm Emanuel can't raise property taxes, so he has to do the small fees in here. He has to keep the cost of government and the cost of politics going in here. And balancing the budget is probably one of the most important functions that a politician can do. I don't know exactly if I agree with the school closings or all the other things that are going around in Chicago right now, but I can tell you outright where McHenry County's at, we've had a whole problem for years about getting a bridge over the Fox River because of some political control, and it's really made an impact on traffic congestion in the area. Where I live, they just recently completed a $30 million bridge project, which has definitely helped in the problem with it, but it was mostly built out of state funds. My whole point here is that you get the government that you pay for. If you want low government, no local control, and a government that doesn't really, and you want basically no government, go to Africa, where they don't have governance. You want an overregulated system, go to someplace like China. I still think that with the power we have in the ballot box, the powers that we have in democratic government, this system to me still works. The only reason it's not is because we, the voters, are not getting educated about the issues, are not doing what we need to do with diligence and holding politicians accountable. I go back to what our founding fathers said. The reason why evil triumphs is because good people do nothing about it. If you're that upset about the government and the politicians, go run for office. If you're that upset about the way the budgets are going, arriving, volunteer for a committee or do something to help get it in there. If you really want to change the system, go out and get involved. I myself know where I stand on the issues. I've made some commitments to some organizations that I firmly believe in, and those and where I think that are going to make some real effective change. I don't want to get into them now because most of you already know where I stand on a lot of these things. The point of the matter is I've gotten involved. I do vote. I do educate myself about the issues. And I find it very ironic that the very people who complain the most are those who don't vote. I can give you a couple of examples of family members of mine. I have an uncle who has never voted in his life, but he is the first one to complain about government spending and excesses and all this stuff. I look at him and I says, okay, why don't you vote? Oh, it's not a big deal. Well, the one thing I do say is this. If you're not voting and you're not participating, what gives you the right to criticize?
Amen, brother. Amen.
You got the right to vote. I've got the right to contribute. Yeah, $9 million worth. I just wanted to add one thing about this library. I forgot I'm a librarian. And in my past, an archivist for the government, many libraries are part of taken from parkland. I was in charge of one right here in suburban areas. They don't have a large footprint. They're owned by municipals, already own the land, it cuts down and things. And what makes you think a presidential library has some footprint? I've been to Carter and Kennedy and the others. It's just a little building. That park goes for miles.
28.
Oh, it's really not. It's more parking lot than anything. There aren't that many documents in these things. I just understand that. And it's very common for their municipal buildings.
Great presentation. Enjoyed it a lot. And do you have a driveway for sale? Good. Okay. I did look up when the question came up about income, and it's not necessarily very clear. For 2012, Kiplinger said $435,000 is the amount to get into that 1%. 22% of the total income is earned by this 1%. Okay, but they do pay 38% of the taxes. Maybe not quite enough, but at least it is a bowing toward a progressive tax system a little. Forbes, on the other hand, says $717,000. This is for 2012. CNN for 2011 says $389,000. So there's a bit of a
there's a bit of disagreement on that. And as I remember, a little over 100,000 gets you into the upper quintile, the upper 20%. However, the point I'm getting at here is this number, this 1% business, which has been going around, is really a symbolic number. Because, as Larry Lessig said, he wrote a book on money in politics. He said that the 99% shouldn't call themselves the 99, they should call themselves the 99.95%. Because in fact, 5% of 1% are the people who give a fair amount of money. And of course, the big contributors in corporation are a much, much smaller percent. The largest asset holders are like 3% of 1% of 1% or some such thing. That's really, really a very a small number of people. However, in the other direction is a symbolic number. As I say, 20% to get in the upper 20 cents, you need to have $100,000 income. And there are some people with $100,000 incomes that are complaining a lot. But once you get into that income, people tend to lay back and say, hey, the system is kind of working for me. And regarding the publicly funded campaigns, which we had some complaints about, I think our political system is just deeply, deeply corrupt just by its nature. All the money that we have in politics and where it comes from, corporations and wealthy individuals and even PACs. And hence, I believe that one of the solutions is this publicly funded campaign. However, this has to be paired with restrictions on how much money candidates can spend. It shouldn't just be a few thousand dollars for the candidates who don't have it. There should be some kind of a cap. And the cap should be implemented from the demand side. In other words, not so much saying you can't spend the money, but nothing to spend the money on. Cutting out a lot of the TV ads. We agree on the garbage ads, okay? Although you say that they aren't any good for anything. They aren't good for winning elections, unfortunately. And that's why politicians spend the money on them. But yeah, we should restrict the amount of money that people can spend on a lot of campaign advertising that they do, especially media, especially TV and radio, but also print. I know that for my local elections, I get a bag this big worth of junk mail during the campaign season. And so that's my feeling on that. One other point I'd like to make, somebody was talking about unions. Unfortunately, for better or for worse, for some reason, a lot of the U.S. population is becoming a little skeptical of unions, particularly public unions, and those are the only ones that have any power anymore. Look at what happened in Wisconsin. Scott Walker attempted to defang the unions. There was a recall, and he still won, which tells us something about the spirit of the American people. And we may have that problem there, too. I don't know,
He's also balanced the budget, reduced
the employment. I would, however, like to end with one of my favorite quotes that I've heard in the last couple years, going to meetings and lectures like this, is from Karen Harris, okay, the president of the teachers union, who unfortunately isn't running. What she said is, do not only
Lewis.
Jesus, I'm glad you corrected me on that, Karen Lewis. All right, I don't want to be on record as making it. Stupid mistake like that. Okay. Anyway, what she said is, ask not only who are the winners and losers, ask who makes the rules, and ask what are the stories that the winners tell to keep the losers playing the game. Thank you.
I missed this presentation. I'm in the city. I think that Prequico lady would live if she ran. Yeah. Seems like a lot of people like her. This 1% stuff, according to Washington Post, it's $500,000 a year. And up, you're a 1%er. But I would look at assets more, and they say 14 million. Who's a 1%er in here? 14 million. Yeah. Anyway, I'm gonna hang out with you guys.
Wannabe. me.
So $14 million and up in assets, personal assets, net assets, I guess you're a 1% or. So, 1% of what? Let me just put it out here about the speed cameras and the red light cameras. And I've had a few tickets, not for speeding, but the red light. This is what would solve it. Just have everybody stop in all four directions or six directions for like 3 seconds at a red light, and you'll never have an intersection accident. And you don't have to spend all that money on all those cameras. Just have everybody friggin' stop for a few seconds, and that's it. No, you know, what they do is they tweak the yellow light length. And it is a money-making scam.
You don't want to stop it?
No, just have everybody have a red light for like a couple seconds. Well, hopefully they...
Skateboards.
So, another thing about 1%ers...
Take money right out of the bank account.
The stimulus thing that went on for 5 years, $4 trillion that went to buying bonds from New York, from the banks and stock brokerages, that ruined the economy 6 years ago anyway. So we bought all these bonds, our government. So everybody up here on the north side in downtown, all these bankers and brokers are like jumping for joy because they got like $3 or $4 trillion. They don't know what to do with it. So I guess it's trickling out, but you know, it's just a shame. And then we got these people in the Tea Party that won't let us raise taxes on those assholes. So, you know, this whole stimulus thing, instead of it going to, you know, nice projects and building transit or building this or building that, real assets in the country, real investments, it goes to these morons in New York, Merrill Lynch and Bank of America and all that. And a Tea Party defends them to the end. So stop listening to right-wing radio, everybody. And that's about all I got.
Next. Okay. Andy Anderson. Andy. And a boy.
Oh, you don't got 5 seconds.
Well, I'd like to add a few observations. For the last, since 2007, I've given a couple of talks a year here on the subject of how the media maintains Americans in a bubble of ignorance and mythology. The 5% of people that live in America, on certain subjects, the public believes things that aren't real, that things are different than what the media portrays. Like, for example, one popular belief was that somehow deluded Americans voted for George Bush and elected that moron. That's not what happened. Less than 25% of registered voters actually voted for Bush Cheney. In 2000, they lost the election, and then when it was clear that they lost, the Supreme Court stopped the vote and gave it to Bush, because the billionaires, as Ted pointed out earlier, we have billionaires, very, very rich people, running our system, and they had decided to install a corporate criminal, a compliant corporate criminal, in the White House to portray the role of the president, while the country could be run by billionaires and their criminal manservants. For 8 years, this country had no president and no vice president. We had two corporate criminals illegally squatting in those offices, masquerading as president and vice president. Imagine what it would have been like to the leader of foreign heads of state of Switzerland, Sweden, France, or Germany to address George Bush as Mr. President. I mean, no wonder that people lost respect. Our system, we're seeing levels of inequality in this country You have to go back to when the pharaohs walked the earth, before there were a handful of people collecting the resources of hundreds of millions of earthly citizens. The level of inequality now is the greatest it's ever been. A handful of billionaires, 85 billionaires own the net worth of half a planet, something like that. On the issue of red, there's another myth. People think the red light cameras are speed cameras for speed control. That's only a handful of them are for speed control. The overwhelming majority are in red light, they're in turning lanes. They are designed to take money off of safe drivers. In basketball, there's something called no harm, no foul. If you touch a person's jersey, they don't call a foul if you didn't cause any harm in the flow of the game. Well, the red light cameras, the right turn cameras are no harm, no foul. People are taking money off safe drivers. Look at where the bulk of those cameras are.
No, when a car touches me, it's no harm.
Let me finish, Charlie.
What I'm trying to talk about is you're trying to list
certain facts, and people from this audience will come up here and say, well, that's not, that you're full of crap. There's some people in this audience that still don't know that an old office complex of 7 buildings losing money was demolished in one day by a demolition company. All 7 buildings were demolished to build something new on the site, and that event was sold to Americans in the media as the terrorist attack of 9/11.
One bullet at a time!
Scott did, we were told that Scott Walker won the re-election and the recall campaign in Wisconsin. But what they didn't tell you is all the voting machines and everything else that were fixed. It's highly possible that the people of Wisconsin voted him out and they just said they changed the vote totals. Like Bush Cheney were voted out in a landslide in 2004. The Las Vegas oddsmakers called it. It was over. They said at 9 o'clock that night, they said if all the votes that haven't been counted yet come in for Bush Cheney, it's over. If everything comes in for them, they still lost it. We went to bed thinking we had voted those criminals out. They changed the vote totals in 11 states, and lo and behold, they came out and announced Bush Cheney were still in. This is the kind of stuff, you talk about how our money is being spent, our tax dollars. It takes $2.3 million to keep a troop in Afghanistan. $2.3 million for a year for one troop over there guarding the new pipeline that's being built for the oil companies. You could take that $2.3 million, bring that guy home and give him a Harvard education, and with the rest of the money, give away 43 hybrids to people that need a car to get back and forth to work.
Amen.
One troop in Afghanistan or a Harvard education and 43 hybrids. What's wrong with this picture of how our money is being spent? And there, Galileo was, the first major scientist to publish the theory that the Earth revolves around the sun, and he got arrested for it. But he was right. People came along behind him with telescopes and said, "Hey, he was right." Took the Catholic Church 300 years to officially apologize for persecuting him, but they came out and made it official. Knowledge in America moves forward as more and more of the public reach critical mass. At one point in this country, it was okay to lynch people and just leave them hanging in trees. The public reached critical mass and said, that's not acceptable anymore. At one point, we had an opium den of haze in restaurants like this, where non-smokers or people that were allergic to smoke couldn't breathe. They just couldn't eat in there because of the density of the cigarette smoke. But the public reached critical mass and accepted the idea that we should be able to breathe clean air. Right now, the public is on the verge of reaching critical mass in the debate about whether or not people deserve to have water if they don't have a job. They're experimenting in Detroit. They're cutting water off. Say, you don't have a job, you can't afford to pay your water bill up, no water for you, shut the meter off. Yeah. But that's a crime against humanity. We have our politicians in this country performing big, big crimes against humanity when other countries are moving forward. Germany put up enough solar panels and shut down 21 nuclear power plants, and they're going after the rest. The future belongs to solar and wind power.
No, it don't.
Yes, it does. And one final thing,
For those of you that want a reality-based evening about what happened on the morning of 9/11 and the political implications, come here 2 weeks from today. Ted's going to give a tremendous presentation on the political implications because the forensic evidence has already been published. There's no debate anymore about what happened on 9/11. It's what we're going to do as a country. And the other thing, 2 weeks after that, I'm going to give a talk on how the media maintains certain people in a state of mythological ignorance long after the facts have been published worldwide. Okay? So there's two good talks, among others, coming up that are reality-based for those of you that are interested. Thank you.
Ready?
I'm going to speak for maybe a couple of minutes.
Okay. Use the mic, Brahm.
Yes.
Can't hear you.
Yeah. The question is, what do you do about all this? Just knowing what's going on takes a lot of time, and I'm not up to it. Most people spend their lives trying to take care of their business, their family, their job, and maybe their neighborhood a little. But beyond that, they are ignorant, even if they read of the Tribune, the capitalist press, because the information in our society, while there is an internet and there are all sorts of sources and so on, is diffuse. The information is very diffuse, and having a handle on it, knowing what you can do and where to express yourself, what the real needs are, is, well, not entirely beyond us, but something to be reached for. You need mechanisms for that. The College of Complex is I'm afraid, not really robust enough to do that. It helps a little to dispel some of our ignorance, but we need something much more than that. And before people put into it, they have to know that it's going to there a handle on their reality. Something effective. That's where unions and political parties and churches even and all sorts of other associations are needed. You've got to talk things over. You've got to understand. You've got to get sources of information. And that's a much bigger job than the political parties we've got, that the capitalists provide for us. They're paid for, you get the best government money can buy. but it's not what we could have. And regardless of how bad the communists were, there are still communists around, and they're still bad. Totalitarians, authoritarians, there are problems. They're state capitalists. Charlie announced a meeting of the Socialist Party. I don't even know when it is. It's going to be here. When?
Tomorrow.
Here at 2 o'clock?
Tomorrow.
Goodness, I might even have to get there. Oh, all right.
All right.
We'll see.
All right, John.
All right.
Lucky has a word for us tonight.
OK.
Okay, yeah, I just wanted to say a few things. I'm sure everybody's getting tired, or at least I know I am. But it's been good to be here at my second College of Complexes, and some of the things that come to mind is I'm pretty jaded, and especially after reading Harry's book, it just made me more jaded and feeling kind of hopeless and helpless, like that the money's always going to win out with electoral politics. And I'm not all for electoral politics. I could understand people who make decisions to not vote and not participate in that way, or choose to put their energy in other places. And they actually do a lot of activist, I've seen people do a lot of activist things other than just complain. But I'll say at this point, I'm probably going to put some of my energy toward working on Chuy Garcia's campaign, because I met him a few weeks ago. He seems like a nice, low-key kind of a guy, so maybe he doesn't have the oomph to, like, kind of, you know, spar with this dude who's, you know, dead fish and all that stuff, and has managed to keep his family pretty much out of the whole scene, too, pretty effectively, I'd say, in the last 4 years. I'm always wondering about the missus, where she stands on all these issues, but we never get to hear that. So I guess I just wanted to share that. So I'm going to, even though I'm jaded, I'm going to go put some energy toward working on that, I think. And I wanted to also weigh in a little bit about the live presidential library, which I didn't thank you for. I had no idea. Like, do people have to pay to go to it, or is it for the 1% or the 0.5 of the 1%?
Tourists go there,
right? And you know, I've seen these different proposals, and I was just like, why do they got to go on our parklands? I mean, come on! I mean, this is the University of Chicago. They got money. They could buy land for all. Yeah, there's lots of areas they could develop. There's lots of areas they could develop. Stay the F out of our parks. There are parks. It's a public space, sacred space. So I'm kind of for keeping that, keeping our spaces that are public, protecting them as much as we can. And that's part of what the school closure fight was about, too, for me, is now all these schools that are closed, they want to develop them into this and that and privatize them. So it's just that whole, like, grab that they're doing that I have a problem with. So I would just say, yeah, not in the parks. There's other proposals. And they say it's up to the Obamas. Well, yeah, whatever. You know, it's up to whoever, whatever. But, yeah, I think I'll be there to, I don't know, you know, put up a tent or whatever if need be, to just make a statement. So I guess I'm just for making statements. And thanks. Good night.
All right.
I
just wanted to do a couple minutes. I happen to have been working at the Art Institute a number of years ago when Harold Washington was mayor. And I don't know if everybody remembers this, but he sent over a couple of his alderman buddies, and they took down a painting off the wall and left the museum with it because they did not like the material that was shown. Today was a good day. I rode up from 18th and State Street on my bike, you know, all the way up here. And why I'm saying that it was a good day is because one of the last times that I was on the Brown Line, I happened to have my bike with me, which is, you know, you can do this. You can ride the train so far and then ride the rest of the way with the bike. It's a lot easier than walking, you know, like from here to Rockville to the station. So there was a couple of black guys that were riding with me, and the guy started asking about my bike. And I said, yeah, I said, today was a good day. And he told me, he says, any day that you're alive is a good day. And also on the topic of bikes, this past summer, the Chicago teachers sponsored a bike ride down through the South Side. And we went all the way down State Street between like 39th and almost down to 55th, where all the projects used to be. It's all been torn down. And we stopped at a number of little grade schools. They're like, this building's been closed now. And then we rode down another three blocks. This building's been closed now. And we rode down another three or four blocks and turned. This one's been closed now. You can turn around and look. There's nothing but empty lots between that school and the next one and the next one. You can see three or four of them in a row. It's like there's nobody there anymore. I don't know what they need all these buildings for. Andy is very correct about the right turn on the red. I also drive, and one time I happened to be waiting for a light on Clark Street and 22nd Street, and the guy pulled up next to me. It was nighttime. He comes to a complete stop. He waited there about 4 or 5 seconds, and he makes a right turn. As soon as he starts to turn, I see flash, flash. And like, he didn't do anything wrong, but the camera would show clearly that he turned right on red. $150. So I'm sure he got a ticket.
It's every life rule.
That's it. You're okay. On. You get the final word.
All right. Well, thank you so much. Just a couple really quick factual things with the speed cameras, just in case you didn't hear. Rahm Emanuel's car has gotten tons of tickets with these speed cameras, and he hasn't, his, you know, car with the driver, and he hasn't paid any of them. That was a good scandal that the, I think, Tribune broke. And then with the library, just the Obama Library, there were other proposals too, like for Bronzeville on the old site of the Michael Reese Hospital, and for the old U.S. Steel site on the south side, and for the Pullman area. So I personally thought those were all kind of good proposals, and better than having the University of Chicago monopolize this. So yeah, that's all the little details I wanted to say. So this was just really an amazing atmosphere and fun to be part of. So thank you.
All right. Very good.
Thank you all for coming.
All right, get a good recovery.
You get home safely, and there's supposed to be a little snow sometime this evening, but I don't see it out there now.
Thank you.
All right. And it gets a little cooler tomorrow.
The shortest yellow line.
Okay.
They didn't seem to know what kind of library
there. There was.
I'm a Reagan library, Abraham Lincoln library, Bill Clinton library.
Oh, yeah.